Very good afternoon to one and all. Here we begin the first session of the afternoon workshop. So it is about remote sensing and its applications in watershed management and groundwater potential zone mapping. It will be dealt by the Honorable Chairman of the Department of Marine Geology. He is the coordinator of geoinformatics and chairman of the Department of Marine Geology. His area of specialization includes geology, geomorphology, remote sensing, GIS, and satellite oceanography. He has guided 8 PhD students and successfully, and 10 students are working for their PhD. He has more than 60 research papers have been published in the national and international journals. He completed 4 research projects funded by the Indian Space Research Organization, Ministry of Environment and Forest, Naval Research Board and Ministry of Earth Sciences. He was awarded National Science Academy Fellowship during 2002 to 2003. He is a life member of Geological Society of India, Indian Society of Remote Sensing and Indian Society of Geomatics. He was the chairman of Indian Society of Geomatics, Mangaluru chapter. He visited International Institute for Aerospace and Remote Sensing, the ITC, in Netherlands during 2001. He wrote a number of popular articles in Kannada newspaper on remote sensing and its applications. He also wrote a book in Kannada on Dura Sampedane Mattu Adara Anvayikate. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Suraj. So, good afternoon to everybody. So, I will be speaking on applications of remote sensing in watershed management. See, wherever you are standing on a watershed. In the sense, if there is a precipitation, that will be drained into the nearby stream. So, wherever you are, definitely you are on a watershed. So I will skip some of the things here because I will speak just for 20 minutes because of the time constraint. See, the fact is we are using remote sensing technology here for the watershed because on a regional scale or a local scale, we talk about regional scale, global scale and local scale. Local scale means cadastral level type of mapping. Maybe if you are concentrating for a particular village like Konaje, we must generate the map on a very, very large scale, maybe of 1:5,000 or 1:6,000, with the finest resolution. I will be speaking in terms of resolution and all. See, we are making use of this satellite data. Maybe again, I am repeating, we must feel proud for ISRO's achievements. In fact, recently, about a month back, we launched a satellite called Cartosat with 25 centimeter resolution images. And after that, we launched one more satellite called Radar Imaging Satellite. Both these satellites are providing less than a meter, 25 to 35 centimeter resolution images. In the sense, if there is an object of 25 centimeter by 25 centimeter on the Earth's surface, it can be detected by a sensor on a satellite. So, in that context, see how best we can make use of this technology, remote sensing technology in watershed management. See, we have the stream network and all, the drainage network we say, how the rivers are flowing. For example, if you consider the Netravati River, in fact, which is, most of you are not aware, it seems, those who are living in Konaje say, without Netravati, we cannot think of our survival. Because we are getting water from Netravati River, from Tumbe Dam, the water is being supplied to Mangalore. We have hardly 4 to 5 workers, but they are not yielding much water. Most of the water, our requirement, campus requirement is about 10 lakh liters per day. And if we harness the entire water which are falling on our rooftop or on the plain area, we can make use of that water for 170 days if it is 10 lakh liter per day. That water we can make use of for 170 days, the water which is being collected on the rooftop. So, but anyhow, we have submitted that report to the university. University will take some decisions regarding that. But what I am going to speak is, see, when we have this kind of satellite images, why we need the satellite data? See, maybe the Western Ghats area, if you consider, most of the rivers are originating in the Western Ghats. I am talking about the West flowing rivers. See, Netravati River, Gurupura River, or we have Mulki, Pavanje, then we have Chakra, Kulluru, Haladi and all. The entire undivided Dakshina Kannada district, including Dakshina Kannada and Udupi district, we have number of river systems. Suppose I want to study the catchment area of Netravati, I need not visit each and every part of the Western Ghats. It is inaccessible area. Maybe some of you are from botany background or from zoology background. See, if you want to study some of the species of the Western Ghats, the forest area, you cannot cover each and every part of the Western Ghats. In a similar way, as a geologist, I cannot cover each and every part of the Western Ghats. They are inaccessible areas. And in such a scenario, if I go for satellite data, that is remotely sensitive data, of course, we have the satellites. In fact, India launched the first Indian remote sensing satellite on 17th March 1988. Since then, we are having the satellite data with different types of resolutions, spatial, spectral, temporal, and radiometric resolutions. Spatial in the sense, just now I said, minimum area of the ground which can be resolved by a sensor. When the first Indian remote sensing satellite was launched on March 17, 1988, that satellite was capable of providing 72.5 meter with LIS-1 sensor and 36.25 meter with LIS-2 sensor. The technology advanced from IRS 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, P1, P2, P3, P4, now we have P4, P5, P6 satellites and all. See, after 1C and 1D, our satellites were renamed as IRS P1, P2, P3 like that, because we started launching satellites from our own soil, from Sriharikota, from Andhra Pradesh coast. Now we are launching the satellites from there, and we have successfully launched hundreds of satellites. Recently, India launched 104 satellites, including foreign satellites. Most of them were foreign satellites to the orbit. We are launching the satellites to the height of 700 to 900 kilometer, and most of these satellites are polar orbiting satellites. They are providing you the repetitive coverage. See, why I need this repetitive coverage in the sense, suppose how much water is available in KRS reservoir or Linganamakki reservoir or in Tungabhadra reservoir. See, there is a need to monitor these changes. That can be studied, water resources of a particular reservoir or how much water is available in the catchment area of a watershed where the river is flowing throughout the year. That means it is a perennial river. Some of the rivers are seasonal rivers. So these things can be monitored. Why I am telling this one is, suppose today a particular satellite passes over your Mangalore area or Netravati river basin, the same satellite will pass over Mangalore after 16 days, 32nd day, 48th day like that. If you divide 365 by 16, about 20 to 24 times the same satellite will pass over an area. That means I can monitor how much water is available in that particular watershed at different seasons. If I, without visiting KRS reservoir or Linganamakki reservoir, by sitting inside the lab, I can say, by the help of satellite data, how much water is there in Linganamakki reservoir or in KRS reservoir, so that the farmer can think of growing for a particular type of crop, how much water is available. If the entire reservoir is full, the water can be released in left canal, right canal, and even the end farmer will get the water for growing the food items. But see, if the water is less, that means there is a need to monitor these dynamic changes. That is possible with multi-dated satellite data. You have multispectral. See, our eyes are sensitive only to the visible region of the spectrum. We can sense the surface features from 0.4 to 0.72 micrometer range of the spectrum. That is why it is called as the visible light. In fact, sun is the chief source for the electromagnetic radiation. Besides Sun, every Earth surface creature emits its own sources of electromagnetic radiation. In a similar way, like our eyes, the eyes present in the satellites, they are capable of sensing in the visible, not only in the visible, they can sense in the thermal region of the spectrum, microwave region of the spectrum. That is why I gave you an example. India launched a satellite called RISAT, radar imaging satellite, wherein during adverse weather conditions, you can collect the required information. Wherever it is raining, see, if you have the cloud cover, optical sensor will not be able to get the required information. Whereas radar technology, microwave, those wavelengths can penetrate through clouds. Irrespective of the weather, you will be able to gather the required information. So by using this technology, we can study, see, we have the ground-based platform, airplane-based, then satellite-based. Of course, in the case of aerial photographs, we are getting through aircraft. Most of you must have studied the topographical maps. The Survey of India generates the topographical maps. Why it is required? The entire Netravati River or Gurupura River is represented on Survey of India topographical maps so that I can extract the drainage network. Morning, Mohammed Nazib and Jagdish Balan are telling, see, the drainage network, Ethinamale or Kumaradhara River, Netravati River, where Netravati and Kumaradhara joins, how many first order streams are there, second order. Now we are talking about the diversion of this Netravati River to the east near Ethinamale. They have constructed dams and all. So what will be its impact on the environment? That is why I am saying I cannot visit each and every part of Kodagu district or Dakshina Kannada district. But if I am good in the interpretation of satellite images, yes, I can generate very useful groundwater resource maps. See, for the generation of groundwater potential zones or wherever we have the problematic areas, yes, our geology students are here. Yes, wherever we are facing acute shortage of water, wherever we have potential zones, see, for that purpose, we have to generate different kinds of thematic maps. I must have the knowledge of geology of that area, what kind of rocks are there, what kind of geological structures are there, where I have the folded rocks, where I have the fractured rocks, jointed rocks, we say lineaments and all. See, those kind of information, wherever the lineaments intersect, that areas are acting as good groundwater potential zones. See, I can demarcate the groundwater potential zone as well as the problematic areas where there is a need for water harvesting, where there is a shortage of water on a global scale, on a regional scale. Maybe if the entire geology students visit a particular area, you may require months together to generate the maps. You cannot visit. Again, Netravati River Basin covers about 4,000 and odd square kilometers, and of which about 10 to 20% is coming under Western Ghats. Steep slopes are there, no road network. In such a scenario, if you are good in interpreting the satellite images, you can generate a geological map by showing the rock types, by showing the structures, then geomorphology, what kind of landforms are there, where you have the fluvial, where you have the denudational landforms. All these landforms can be mapped, that is geomorphology. In a similar way, water-bearing geomorphological units I can extract, that is called hydrogeomorphology. In a similar way, water-bearing geological formations, hydrogeology, land use, land cover, what type of land cover is there and for what purpose that particular land is being used. See, morning speakers were telling about the P-tile. Actually, we are placing everywhere concrete roads, metal roads and all. The fact is, whenever there is a precipitation, most of the water will be drained into the nearby streams. See, we are facing acute shortage of water due to this reason also. So, we may be having plenty of precipitation, but if you create everywhere the concrete roads, metal roads, asphalt roads, the water will be drained. So, impervious layers can be mapped based on the satellite data. Pervious means infiltration, percolation will be there. So, soil moisture will be retained, but in an impervious layer, water will be drained into the nearby stream. So these things, that is why it is not only creating the water shortage, even the heat islands we are creating. If you go for such kind of concrete buildings, maybe I am repeating once again, after Bengaluru city in Karnataka, Mangalore city is having highest number of multi-storied buildings. Maybe even if you go to Mysore, Hubli, Dharwad, they are the second, third largest cities in Karnataka. But in Mangalore, we have number of multi-storied buildings, 30-storied buildings, 40-storied. Everywhere we are creating the concrete buildings. The fact is, it is an interesting research topic. In fact, these concrete materials, metal roads, they absorb the electromagnetic radiation. They retain the energy. They emit the energy during night time. That is why if you consider, say, maybe in Konaji also the same thing is happening. If you compare the temperature of Konaji area, Dr. Jagdish Bala was telling the importance of vegetation, the trees, see, that is very much important. We must grow more and more vegetation. The fact is, see, whenever we have this kind of concrete buildings, they trap the energy, they retain the energy, they emit the energy during night time. That is why inside the cities, if you compare the temperature of Hampanpetta area or Konaji area with the suburban area, here you have plenty of vegetation. Here the temperature is higher than that area. In the forest area, you may be having plenty of vegetation. There is a mechanism called potential evapotranspiration. But these buildings doesn't have that kind of capability. So they absorb all the electromagnetic radiation. Because of that, inside the concrete building, you are feeling more warmer. And we are creating such kind of urban heat islands. So that will create lot of problems. Most of your diseases occur because of this heat islands and all. So in that context, how best we can... Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. So, see, the temperature is increasing. Now, there is a need for reducing the temperature. How best we can make use of it? The developed countries now, see, they are going for pervious asphalts. They are manufacturing pervious asphalts, pervious concrete roads. So that whenever there is a precipitation, the water will be infiltrating, the soil moisture will be retained. But here, you must have read it in the newspaper, if there is a rainfall of 6 to 7 centimeter in Bangalore, some of the low-lying areas will get submerged, flooded and all. See, that is mainly because of this creation of impervious layers. So, with that context, see, we have the aircraft, we have the spacecraft, of course. Most of the satellites, see, India launched a series of satellites. And most of these polar orbiting satellites are orbiting from an altitude of 700 to 900 kilometers. And they are providing us the repetitive coverage. In the sense, I said in the beginning, one particular satellite may cover Bangalore area around 24 times in a year's time. So that I can monitor the significant changes, how much water is available in Tumbe Reservoir during January, February, March, April, May. If they rise the dam height, how much water will be there, again which are the areas get submerged and all, that kind of information I can gather through remotely sensing data. In the sense, they are providing us the repetitive coverage, multispectral information. In the sense, I said we are capable of sensing only one particular wavelength. If you click the camera, you are getting only one output, but it is not in the case of satellites. If you click the camera of a particular satellite, it records the signals in the blue region, green region, red region, and in the near infrared region of the spectrum, as well as in the thermal microwave portion of the spectrum. That means simultaneously it records the signals in more than one wavelength of the electromagnetic spectrum, and that concept is called multispectral concept. Why it is being used is different surface features will behave differently at different wavelength of the spectrum. This you can skip. See, the basic principle is when energy is reaching the Earth's surface, it interacts with the Earth's surface features. And see, part of the light will be reflected, part is absorbed, and part is transmitted. These three will be different for different Earth's surface features, and based on that, we will be able to differentiate the surface features on a remotely sensed data. Of course, this is a satellite which records the upwelling electromagnetic radiation. Next slide. See, this is the basic principle. You have the sources of energy, then it interacts with the surface features. Before that, it has to pass through the atmosphere. Then we have the low altitude aircraft and high altitude spacecraft.
Then they collect the signals. We have an earth receiving station located at Hyderabad called National Remote Sensing Service Center. Whenever the Indian satellites passes over, the Indian student or town planner and agriculturist can make use of the same satellite data for number of applications. Yes, if I wanted to extract the watershed related information, I can make use of the satellite data. Your wildlife habitat assessment studies can be carried out through remotely sensed data. Based on the flora, I can study the fauna. It is possible. So finally, the data will be processed through visual and digital image processing techniques, and we are generating different types of information system in the form of maps. If it is related to watershed, I will be extracting the watershed related information. I said groundwater potential zone, where the chance of getting groundwater is more. For that, you require the geology of the area, what type of rocks are there, what type of structures are there, geomorphology, the land forms, the land use, land cover. If three crops are grown in an area, definitely you can say sufficient water is available. It could be from the surface or from the groundwater. Three crops are grown in an agricultural area. See, like that, the slope map, if there is a steep slope, runoff will be more. Based on the drainage density, the drainage network, if the drainage density is more, surface runoff is more. In a similar way, you generate maybe 8 to 10 thematic layers by using the satellite data. Then it is possible to integrate all the thematic layers one over the other, and based on the integrated approach, I will be able to say where the chance of getting groundwater is more, or where the problematic areas are existing, based on the geology, geomorphology, land use, land cover, slope, aspect, shaded relief, number of maps can be generated. That is what it is called as an integrated approach. So on this slide. See, this is how the energy interacts with the surface features. Reflection, absorption and transmittance will be there. See, this is one a wave. See, there are hundreds of satellites orbiting over the globe now. The orbit is crowded. There is a traffic jam in the space. In fact, every day the developed countries are launching a satellite weighing from 2000 kg, 1000 kg, 500, 200, 10, 5, 2, less than a kg satellites are being launched. In a similar way, India is also launching satellites. That means there is a crowded orbit. That is why there is an international commission has been set up, and they are allotting the slots where to launch the satellites and all. So anyhow, there are hundreds of satellites orbiting over the globe, and they are providing the required information. As a student of geology or botany or zoology or an agriculture scientist, we must extract some meaningful information from the remotely sensed data. Next slide. See, these are Indian remote sensing satellites. Different types of, so we launched the first satellite in 1988 on March 17th, LIST 1, LIST 2 with 72.5 meter and 26.25 meter. And see, one more satellite recently, not recent one, about 15 years back we launched, and in this OceanSat 2 is being launched recently. These satellites are useful for potential fishing zone mapping. See, I can monitor where to go for fish catching. I can direct the fishermen where to go for fish catching based on the ocean color information. Wherever you have more chlorophyll, you are getting green color of the oceanic surface. Then wherever you have high biological productivity, that will be showing some temperature difference. Now integrate the ocean color monitor information with the sea surface temperature information and generate a potential fishing zone map and direct the fishermen where to go for fish catching. How far it is from Bangalore port area, old port area, new port area, in which direction you must go for fish catching. Maybe morning hours you have to go 10 to 12 kilometers southwest of Bangalore. Maybe the same area cannot be providing fish in the evening. So for that purpose, some of the satellites are capable of covering the same area twice a day. You have the morning pass, you have the evening pass. So with that, definitely you can update the required information. That is possible. So we have number of satellites for that applications, oceanographic land applications and all. Of course, this is the latest. In this series, we have launched recently a satellite called CartoSat 3, which provides 25 centimeter resolution with 4.5 target viewing capability. That means you can get the height information also, not only the length, the width, even we can measure the volume of water available in a particular reservoir. Length, width, as well as the height information of an area can be obtained. And seasonal variations can again be carried out by using multi-data. Next slide. You can skip this also. Related to satellites, I will stop with, see, these are the, see, it takes about 90 minutes to complete one full revolution of the Earth. A particular satellite will require 90 minutes. These are the geostationary satellites. Indian National Satellite is a geostationary satellite. You are getting the weather reports, or you are getting hundreds, thousands of TV programs that are all possible with your Indian National Satellite. It is a communication satellite. There is a sensor called very high resolution radio meter, which provides the, it transmits the signals, and we are collecting those signals. It is a multi-purpose satellite. We are predicting the monsoon well in advance by studying number of parameters of the atmosphere, the cloud top temperature, liquid water vapor content in the atmosphere. All these can be measured with the help of that type of satellites. But we are interested to know more about the polar orbiting satellites. It requires 90 minutes to complete one full cycle of the Earth. Orbit is from north to south, so that I can monitor how much water is available in a particular watershed at different seasons. See, by the time the satellite completes one full cycle of the Earth, Earth is also rotated from west to east. That means if the first orbit is over Mangalore area today around 10:30, after 90 minutes, the orbit will be at a gap of 2,700 kilometers west of Mangalore. So like that, on a particular day, you have 14 orbits. But next day's first orbit will be adjoining to the first orbit of the previous day. The second orbit will be adjoining to the second orbit of the previous day. Like that, second day you have 14 orbits, third day 14 orbits. In a span of 16 days, the entire world will be covered, and the same satellite will be over Mangalore on the 17th day, 34th day. Like that, you are getting the repetitive coverage that is very much required for monitoring a watershed or the dynamic changes occurring in the oceanic surface, urban sprawl, the type of crops grown in an area. If I want to study the type of crops grown in Mandya district, how much area is covered with paddy, how much area is covered with sugar cane, I can make use of this satellite data. Even based on the healthiness of the vegetation, even the yield can be calculated. That is possible with this type of satellite. See, these are providing the detailed information with 1 meter, less than a meter. These are geostationary satellites. They are providing global coverage. Next slide. Next, you can skip this. See, this is how the satellite orbit from north to south, the solid, and the dashed line is on the ground, which covers that much area, how much area it covers, and the inclination you see, that is why it always passes the equator at the same local centile. That is why these type of satellites are called as sun synchronous polar orbiting satellites. Next slide. See, this is what is the first orbit is today over Mangalore. The second orbit will get a gap of 2,700 kilometers or 2,800, third orbit, fourth orbit, like that. You have 14 orbits. But second day's first orbit will be adjoining to the first orbit of the previous day. Second orbit will be adjoining to the second orbit of the previous day. Like that, the entire surface of the Earth will be imaged by a satellite. So we have to this, we can speak different kinds. See, this is the course resolution, 2004 Olympics at 6 venues. See, you can see only the course resolution information, but one of the venues, course venue, you can see with 13 kilometers square, with the 4 meter spatial resolution. This spot satellite provided 20 meters, whereas this icon also provides 4 meter. See, here you may not be able to identify the sports ground, but here the rectangular shape or circular shape, oval shape, based on that you can say the settlements, built up areas, you can easily differentiate based on the satellite data. This is of course provides you the high resolution. Next slide. See, this is same area, but imaged from different angles, and this type of images will provide 3D information. Next slide. See, of course, that is the false color composite, where the vegetation is represented by red color. Here it is true color. For us, vegetation looks green. But see, the satellite images provided, because they can collect collect the data even in the near infrared region of the spectrum, and in the near infrared vegetation reflects maximum light. Definitely the left one is more usable, okay, for vegetation differentiation. See, now what are the advantages? Suppose, see, this is Manasa Sarovara area of the Himalayan terrain. See, I cannot visit each and every part of this Himalayan terrain, but now I can say what is the aerial extent of this water body. Maybe after some time the water spread area will reduce. See, there is a need for seasonal changes. That can be possible with the satellite data. It provides synoptic coverage. That means as you go higher and higher, you will be able to see a larger area, and that is what it is called as the synoptic coverage. Then you are getting the repetitivity. Same area will be imaged number of times. The advantage is you can monitor the dynamic changes. Inaccessible areas can be covered. Information in spatial domain, in the sense how much area is covered with forest, how much area is covered with water, square kilometer, that is the spatial data. Data is quantifiable, and even the historical data are available. Some 20 years back, 30 years back, land use, land cover changes, plenty of vegetation where there, agricultural fields where there, about 30, 40 years back, in and around Mangalore. Like Jagdish Bala was telling, from Udupi to Mangalore, you had plenty of paddy fields about 30, 40 years back. Now the scenario has changed. Everywhere we are constructing these concrete buildings. So there will be a change in the land use, land cover pattern, and what will be the impact on the environment. We can study those kind of things with the help of historical data. Next slide. This is of course Mangalore area, Netravati. See, four villages, Konajai Grama, Harekala Grama, Nalingana Grama and Balayapuni. And where you have the tabletop, especially Konajai, in all sides we have the slopes. So whenever there is a precipitation, see, if it is flowing towards north, then this water will goes to Netravati River. If it is in this direction, there is one more Talapati stream or something is there. Like that, see, we can monitor. There you have the smaller river, the watershed. When we talk about watershed, we have the major watersheds like Netravati. Then if I am concentrating only Kumaradhara, Kumaradhara is the sub-basin of river Netravati. Kumaradhara is originating near Subramanya. Netravati is originating in the Western Ghats. The morning our speakers were telling, see, earlier there were floods, there were droughts, but it is having gaps, it was having some gap. Now the scenario has changed. Maybe during August 20 you have the floods, maybe during August last week you have the drought situation. Because the fact is, in the same area you are experiencing, you must have read it in the newspapers, there is no water flow in the upstream of river Netravati. ಈ ಬಹುಶಃ ಪತ್ರಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಓದಿರ್ತೀರಿ. ಯಾಕೆ ಈ ಸಿನಾರಿಯೋ ಆಯಿತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಪಶ್ಚಿಮ ಘಟ್ಟಗಳ ಕಾಡುಗಳು ಇವತ್ತು ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಆಗಿತ್ತು. ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಇಯರ್ ದೇರ್ ವೆರ್ ಸಿವಿಯರ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಕೊಡಗು ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್. ನಾವು ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಸಿಚುವೇಶನ್ ಅರೈಸ್ ಇನ್ ಬೆಳ್ತಂಗಡಿ ತಾಲೂಕ್ ಆಫ್ ದಕ್ಷಿಣ ಕನ್ನಡ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್. ಸಿ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಘಾಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಪ್ಲೇಸಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಫರ್ಟೈಲ್ ಸಾಯಿಲ್ ವಿತ್ ಫರ್ಟೈಲ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮಸ್ ವಾಸ್ಟ್. And see, because of that landslide, most of the areas are now barren. The rocks are exposed and they cannot, there the water cannot infiltrate. So the groundwater is less. That is why most of the streams are becoming dried up during immediately after the monsoon season. So these things can be again monitored with the help of remotely sensitive data. It's like, see, of course, this is the topographical map of the same area, Konajai area. I said you are having number of maps available. Make use of this and generate some more maps. See, Konajai, Nalingana and all. This is of course the Netravati River. The drainage network and all you can study with the help of this topographical map. Again, it is generated based on 3D aerial photographs. Harekala village, again in detail, see, wherever you have the paddy fields, wherever you have the other vegetated areas, lateritic terrains, all this information I can gather, I can generate a very useful map. Of course, this is a true color imagery. I am getting, if I go for satellite images, I will be getting the false color composite, and with that I can generate some more useful maps. This is again the same area, Konajai Grama. So you can see the 400 meter track, your science blocks and your administrative blocks, so much of details. The picture is worth than thousands of words. A Chinese flower says this. Balakuni Grama. Okay, see again on a regional scale, so much of details you are getting from the images, the road network, how, where you have the vegetated areas, where you have the non-vegetated areas, where you have the lateritic exposure center. See, you have to select some suitable sites for artificial recharge as well as groundwater potential zones. All this information, these are all Google images. Iconos Satellite provides this kind of information. Next slide. So this is again on a regional scale. And in fact, we have carried out a study for the entire campus by using, see, in science block, how much water will be collected if there is a rainfall of this much during monsoon season, pre-monsoon season, and post-monsoon season, and how much water can be collected from each building. Majority of the buildings we have covered. So this you can skip. The science block, the administrative block, the library. So some of the buildings, ladies hostel and all. Next. See, this is actually they have implemented in ladies hostel. See how best we can make use of this. See, this is nothing but you are recharging the boreholes by creating a pit so that pebbles, then you have top pebbles, then medium size, then fine material, 40 centimeter jelly, 20 centimeter jelly, like that you have to put inside the concrete. See, then you can even recharge the abandoned boreholes. The boreholes which were dug about 20 years back, 30 years, cannot be yielding water. But definitely, now it can be recharged. If you pump water to that, maybe 5,000 liters of water to the abandoned borewell, if all the water enters into the borewell, then such type of borewells can be recharged. If the water is coming out immediately, such type of borewells cannot be recharged. But anyway, we can think of going for recharging the aquifers. Water-bearing geological formations are called as aquifers. Now there is a need for recharging the aquifers. We are discharging more and more water from the wells, from the bore wells. But even if we go to the depth of, it was not experienced earlier in Dakshina Kannada, because warning speakers were telling we are getting 3,500 to 4,000 millimeter of rainfall. But even then, some of the areas are experiencing severe. See, even if you go to a depth of 1,000 feet, now we are not getting water. Some of the borewells that has happened in Dakshina Kannada district also. So in that context, there is a need for recharging the aquifers. Next slide. Of course, this is near the ladies' hostel. Next. So, this is how you can recharge. So, these are some of the recharging structures implemented in our campus. Next. You can skip this, please. Skip on the other. See, again, there is a, see, speakers were telling about the importance of check dams and all. There is a stream, Panaji stream. We can construct some nala ponds or check dams across the stream, definitely we can store the water and the water level can be increased. So especially the water table we can increase by constructing such kind of nala ponds or check dams across the streams. This is near Shoram Park, Dakshina Kannada. Next slide. Next. Next. Of course, the vegetation and you can easily differentiate. Here we have the coconut vegetation, fallow land, built up areas and all. See, I said we are experiencing floods as well as droughts. See, this is near Vidupe. You see, because of that landslide in the Western Ghats, see, so much of sediments brought by the rivers and there was a flood and all. See, so much of sediments, now sand is accumulated here. See, they are complete well submerged under this, so much of sediment deposition, that is why again they are repairing that well by removing that soil, and you can see the movement of this water and how so much of damage it caused because of that landslide occurred near Baitagadi. Some of the streams changed their courses also. Next, Charmadi. See again, see, whenever you have so much of soil is being removed from the Western Ghats, definitely that areas are exposed to sun. That is why immediately after few days of rainfall, see, the area will not have sufficient ground water, so you will not have any springs there. That is the reason. That is why maybe you see this time we have received monsoon, even day before yesterday there was rainfall. But with all that, we may face water shortage during peak summer. We must be ready for that. That is why Mangalore City Corporation is planning to increase the height of Tumbe Dam by 1 more meter. Now they are planning to store 7 meter of water. Earlier it was up to 6 meter. Now from this year onwards, they will store 7 meter height. Up to that height, they will store the water. The result is some of the villages will be submerged. But they have to give sufficient compensation for that. But this is how we are experiencing floods and droughts because of the soil removal, fertile soil. There is no soil at all to infiltrate the water whenever there is a precipitation. It's like, let's see, you can see this is happened here, Charmadi area. See, so much of these are all alluvial plains. See, so much of sediment got accumulated here. See, again, these are some of the sea. You can see the blocks of these trees and all. See, up to the broken ridges and all, you can see. This is happened. See, here you see the thickness of the sediment, especially the sand, got accumulated. This is again here, Beltangadi. In fact, we carried out a study on landslides of this area and what will be its impact. See, landslides again can be studied with the help of multi-dated satellite data. Prior to the landslide, what was the condition of Beltangadi taluk? Immediately after the landslide, what has happened? In a gap of 1 month, I am getting the satellite data. With that, I can generate very useful resource maps. Next slide. See, here again you can see, this is near that Mondangiri area, on the way to Jodhupala, after Jodhupala, on the way to Mysore. See, you can see, even at the, wherever you have the first order strip, see, there is a severe landslides and all, so much of vegetation got removed from this area, and wherever, see, such a type of features are there, they are mainly because of the landslides. And because of that, now sufficient soil cover is not there, vegetation cover is not there, the result is, there is a drying up of rivers. Next photographs of that same area, that Ponnangiri, Jodhupala and Makkandur areas, there the severe landslides occurred, see, from the hilltop, so much of sand being removed, and now there is no soil, fertile soil or humus rich soil, and if there is a humus rich soil, more infiltration will be there. The scenario has completely changed. Next slide. See, this is how you can see. These are some of the photographs. See, this is near Makkandur. There is a place called Makkandur where the severe landslide occurred. See, the wooden walls and all. This is especially of Kodagu district. See, everywhere the soil is being removed. See, severe landslides and all. You can see the filled up. Of course, this is a color monster composite of the satellite imagery. Our Netravati River is here, Gurukula River is here. So that is also called as Kalgudi River. See, one advantage of satellite remote sensing is, see, during this period the river is dry. The Gurukula River is dry, there is no water flow. But see, in the case of Netravati River, there is a flow. That means Netravati River is a perennial river, whereas Gurukula River is a seasonal river. Yes, this kind of analysis I can carry out by using multi-dated satellite data. Even the breakwaters you can see near the port area. Here again two breakwaters are there. One is near Bengre, one is near Ullal. See, wherever you have red color is there, they're all vegetated areas. Next slide. Again, see, from the catchment area, this is Netravati, this is Kumaradhara. This place is Uppinangadi. From there, the river is called as Netravati River. The western class, see, this is a reservoir. See, I can monitor when I go for this kind of analysis, how much water is available in this reservoir. That two different seasons are required during March, April, May and all. So that can be analyzed by using more than one dated satellite data. Netravati, Gurukul, Mulki, Pavanje, Udyavara River, Sita, Swarna, Chakra, Kolduru, Haladi. See, so much of information you are gathering on a particular satellite imagery. What in this you can better management practices, when we talk about the watershed. See, this is again very high resolution satellite images, the aerial extent of the water body sent out. Next slide. Again, you see the drainage network. You can skip. Again, these are the suspended sediments concentration, and we can study. Of course, this is an island. Very high resolution satellite images providing 30-40 centimeter resolution. Next, again, water body and different types of surface features. What type of rocks are there? What type of landforms are there? So all these details can be studied. Again, this is a 3D scene of mangrove area, and there you have the Konaje, and this in between Konaje and Netravati and Gurupur, you have mangrove city. Of course, the topography of the area, this is of course 3D view of the terrain. Where the elevation is highest, where it is having lower elevation is low. Okay, I will stop here. But see, without any physical contact, we are remotely collecting the data through aircrafts or spacecrafts, and when we analyze these things properly, we are in a position to extract meaningful information related to watershed or to related to geology or oceanography. So watershed is an important topic, and whenever we need to have some more details of a particular watershed, where the problematic areas are there, where we have more water is available, this type of things can be extracted by the analysis of remotely sensed data. Okay, I will stop here. Thank you, one and all, for your. Any questions? Okay, thank you. Sir, Ninja, question, sir.
Hi.
Yes sir, with the high resolution, highest resolution images, I said 25-30 centimeter resolution images are available. See, smallest unit of the surface can be detected through satellite technology now. With that type of, you can go for with that type of images, definitely the cadastral level information, the village level information can be extracted. Minute details of the surface can be detected. So it is possible.
But the department has given this information, they start planning for that.
Yes,
definitely. Helpful for me.
But we require the highest resolution satellite data.
How to get that?
That you have to approach NRS in Hyderabad. So, but there is a need, you have to pay. The whoever goes for that kind of analysis, they have to get the project, or if they have money, then they have to request NRSC Hyderabad. What type of data products are required and all that, you have to communicate with them. And once you get the required satellite data, then you can start the interpretation and you can extract the required information.
Is it economical or
possible? No, it is economical because see. Yes, depending upon the purpose, and if it is larger area and for multi-purpose, definitely the satellite images are very useful. I said inaccessible areas can be covered. See, if I want to study the landslides of a particular region, I cannot go.
It takes time.
It takes time. Even if a team of students goes there, they cannot cover each and every part. But with the help of remotely sensed data, yes, multi-spectral, multi-dated images are available. You have to explore the optical, thermal, microwave, radar, radar technology. Number of technologies are available. Integrate all these. Try to extract some more information. That is possible.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.